Howdy folks, we have got a Crosley Shelvador here that has quite a patina built up on it. This was given to me by some friends. He and his wife, I think, purchased a property that had an old camper trailer on it, just dilapidated. And they found this Crosley in that camper trailer and saved it before the trailer got to hauled off. Oh, we even got hinge covers. Obviously, the shelves in here are missing, but those will be pretty easy to make or come by. We come back here to the back. Still got leaves and acorns and stuff in it. The sad thing was I had a lot of work for a couple of years, really long assignments overseas. And this sat outside for a long time because they just didn't have anywhere to put it. And I'm fortunate that it still exists, you know, let alone the condition of it. But if, I'd rather have something than not have anything. See if we can determine if this thing's still viable or not. A lot of rust in there. I don't think it's rusted through, although there are some holes drilled there with bolts in them. So one thing about the Crosley Shelvador fridge, it is kind of an important piece of history. Crosley was the first brand to have this storage in the door. And of course the Shelvador is a play on words for shelves in the door. And this one is missing one piece at the bottom, but you can see that it has this place to put eggs and bottles, etc. in the door. Whereas the rest of the fridge is very conventional for a 40s or 50s model. Now, Crosley came out with this design in the 1930s. They were the only company that, in the States, that sold a fridge with shelves in the door from the 30s all the way up into the 50s. And they had a patent on it, on this door storage, and they would not license it to anybody, and they would go after anyone that infringed on it. So if you got a fridge with this storage on the door, it was going to be a Crosley. And other than that, Crosley was a radio, tube radio manufacturer. So this was kind of a branch out product for them, and they capitalized on this idea of the storage in the door. So for that reason, these are kind of a cool piece of history and something to hang on to. The later Crosleys, they were actually built by Kelvinator Company, another big fridge manufacturer, to Crosley spec. And the only difference between the Kelvinator branded and Crosley branded fridge was the door liner, this plastic liner. For Kelvinator, it was flat. For Crosley, it had the shelves in it. And then, of course, the exterior emblems. But most of the Shelvadors, this one, I'm not sure about it. This may be a little earlier, but most of them are actually Kelvinator, have the same exact Kelvinator compressor system. And the only part that's special for Crosley is the door liner and the trim. So, for example, this is a Frigidaire. You can see nothing on the door. This is a Stuart Warner. Nothing on the door. All these other models have just a smooth, plain door. Well, before I put the camera on the tripod, I went ahead and took the front cover off. Get a view of the condenser. Looks like we got a Delco Hotwire relay for the starting. Well, I don't like that. You can see the electricity in those wires. But I don't know. I think we're going to man up and plug it in. All right, so the first thing I'm going to do is see if we have a complete circuit or not. So get this meter where we can see it. Like that. And again, we're checking resistance. So that's in ohms scale, resistance scale. Right now it's reading mega ohms, so it's a very, very high resistance because there's nothing touching. So it's just a two-wire cord, so I'm going to measure from one wire pin of the cord to the other, like that. We have 2.8 ohms, which that's a very good solid circuit, which that's very encouraging because, you know, we're dealing with a compressor motor that should have a copper winding in it. And it's just a one continuous loop of wire from one side here through the thermostat through the winding and back, so it should be a low resistance like that. Next check, from both sides to ground, or to the chassis of the fridge, and there's half a mega ohm. which is really too low. I want to see 1 meg or more before I run it, but in this case, I'm not going to care. I'm going to run it anyway, because if the wiring burns up, it's shot anyway. I've lost nothing. And I am going to be monitoring the current demand, because if the hot wire relay is bad or something and it's pulling too much current, I don't want to harm the compressor. I do care about that. Try to get the current meter on the screen there. So, without further ado, here we go. Well, it ran for a second and then the breaker tripped in the hot wire relay. I let everything reset and then give it one more try. And if it doesn't go, I'm going to take these terminals off down here and get a test cord. Here we go for another start attempt. Nope, something's wrong with that start relay. So in that case, go to plan B and hook up directly on the compressor. After that short run attempt, I hear some noise in there, at least there's something in there. But I'm pretty sure this is why it didn't successfully start. All I can say is these terminals, they look terrible. I don't really know if I'm going to be able to get them off or not. So in the interest of just checking the compressor out, I'm probably going to just cut back this cable and try to strip it and get alligator clips on it. And then assuming the compressor is viable, I'll work on making proper connections to it. And of course, the first thing is going to be to identify which terminals do what. So to that end, I'm going to go ahead and just strip these back where I can hook them up to or test them with the meter. I don't want them touching ground like that. So if I go from the leftmost terminal to the center terminal, I get 9.7. From left to the rightmost, I get 3.8. And then from center to the rightmost, I get 6.0. So it looked like the highest reading, the 9.6, was from the left to the center. So that would tell me the one not involved in that is common. So that's going to be this one to the right. So I'm going to assume this one to the right is common. And it is going to go to the neutral on the power cord. So I've got a test cord here. I'm just going to hook it up like that to the neutral. Some of this other stuff out of the way. Now, from the neutral, common, I'm going to look for the one of these that has the higher resistance. There's 3.9. There's 6.1. So this one with the higher resistance, that should be the start. And on this RO81, the start is the white wire. So I'm using this jumper lead, so start's going to clip there. Then through process of elimination, this one's got to be run. So we'll hook the run wire up to that. Like so. And what that should do is allow the compressor to be run without any of the factory fridge wiring involved. So regardless of the condition of the start relay or any of the other components that could be causing that high current draw, it was drawing about 7 amps and tripping its breaker inside the hot wire relay. So hopefully with this external start device, we're going to bypass whatever's wrong, actually see it run correctly. So back to amps mode, here we go again. See, 2.7 amps, that seems a little more reasonable. And the fact that it's climbing would be a good thing, because it means there's at least some pressure in the system to build up. That's very encouraging. At least we got sound in there. Not sure exactly how the circuit is routed. Oh yeah, this is ice cold on top. These three on top must be the first passes from the cap tube. Yeah, it goes through these three loops on top, and then it comes down right here and goes through the shell of the evaporator. Oh yeah, it's cooling well. Give it some time. Can't read much of that. Looking at the hot wire relay, February 7th, 1952. Delco Products Division of General Motors, 1/8 horsepower. We'll take this apart, look at the condition inside it. Start by trying to get all the old wiring off of there. Not throwing everything across the room. These use an interesting technology. You'll see it when it's opened up, what I'm talking about. But there is no relay coil in here, and no bimetallic strip or anything like that. It is a piece of wire made of a special alloy that's under tension. And that wire, special alloy, expands when it gets hot to a very great degree. It's a very high thermal expansion coefficient. So when current passes through that wire and warms it up, it gets longer, and that movement actuates the mechanical parts of the relay. And because it depends on that wire heating up from current, if this thing is full of water or something that absorbs the heat and it can't heat up, it'll keep the relay from shifting out of start mode. And then if that continues and it's full of water all the way up to the overload point, it'll keep the overload breaker from heating up and tripping. And really, it'll wreck the compressor at that point. So this one is doomed now because those studs broke off in there, but we're still going to learn how it works. Figure out how to get it out of the case. I think that's a rivet, but it's so rusted. Everything in it's so rusted. I'm gonna go off camera and try to figure out how to get that out. Yeah, I would say that explains why it didn't work right. But that little silver wire right there, that is the hot wire, part of the hot wire relay. And as that expands, it actuates a lever action here. And I'll go get a variac and a transformer and hook up to this and put some current through it and see if we can see how it works. So the variac and the transformer let me make a simulation with this. I want to be extremely clear, this relay is never to be applied directly across AC input power. Never. It's intended to be in series with a motor where the current flows through this and then a motor winding, and it's measuring the current going through the motor. It's never to be powered up across the line. It would just instantly destroy it. But this transformer will let me simulate the current flow from a motor winding. And this rusted metal part, that would be the common input to the relay, the live line one. And that current will go through the hot wire, the silver wire, and then into this arm mechanism. And you have the start and run contacts down here. So one of them should open first and stop the current to the start winding. And then if the high current continues, the second one will trip open, and that will be the overload breaker. So I'm going to turn on the transformer. I'm going to set this down because if I'm holding it and moving it around, it may make it hard to see what's happening. So I'm going to get this where it's right on the screen, zoomed in. Like I said, I want you to be able to see what actually is happening. So these two points here are the overload breaker and the start winding contact. And that silver wire, that's the hot wire that's going to expand. So I'm going to start putting current through it now. You see the arm moving? Now the start contact opened on the right. Now see, I tripped the overload. I went too far with it. If I turn off the current, given enough time, that wire will cool off and shrink, and everything will reset. It's ingeniously simple. I don't know what that wire is made out of. It may be something that's real exotic and expensive. That may be why you don't see these anymore. I just don't know. Now they use a PTC, positive thermal coefficient, start device, which it also works on a similar high-level idea that it warms up and then changes into a open circuit, basically, and turns off the start winding. And this actually does it mechanically, but it does it through thermal expansion. So here we'll go again for another simulation. Arm is moving. Trip. I'll turn off the power. Because these contacts are shot. If I hook up here, I don't get any current flow, and the contacts cannot break the circuit through the hot wire, so if I didn't turn off this power, it would damage it and burn it out, which, even though it's crap, you know how I am. I don't believe in destroying things wantonly, even if they're junk. I think that leads to bad karma. Hopefully I have another one of these somewhere that's in good shape. If not, then I'll just use this housing and put a modern PTC relay in there. Here's one from 1964. It looks a little bit nicer. So this one actually works as designed. I have the power coming in on the line input, goes through the hot wire, and then it's going out through the start contact. So when I flip on the switch, it's going to simulate a motor start. And you see how once it tripped off, it started moving back because that broke all the current through it. It should just cycle back and forth. Normally, there'd always be current through the run winding, and that keeps this just warm enough so it doesn't reset the start. But because I don't actually have a motor hooked up, I just have this transformer set up, I can't simulate that. The problem with these is, and with all thermal relays, how long it takes it to reset. Because if you turn the compressor off and right back on, it's not going to start because that thing hasn't cooled off yet. I'll turn it off. Now if I change over and move this to the run winding or main winding input, now it should trip both the contacts open. But I'm going to wait for the start one to close first. So everything's reset. This time it should trip open the start winding, and then it should continue to heat and trip open the main winding or the overload breaker. Again, that would simulate a fault condition where too much current flowed to the motor. Takes it a little while to reset. Yep, now it's ready to go again. Ramping up the current. I brought the current back down, but not all the way off. It would stay like that while the motor's running in the middle. And if while it's running it gets overloaded and the current creeps up too high, it would trip off. Interesting old technology. Been running for about a half an hour. 2.3 amps, 184 watts. Sounds nice. Been running with the door open though. Look in there. This thing's kind of white on the inside anyway, so it's hard to tell the difference, but it's definitely frosted. Quite a hard frost too, because we've got warm weather and humidity. You can look back in there, it's all the way through the accumulator. So yeah, looks like the compressor and the system is good on this one. My only concern, the rust is so profound that a line might break when I'm working on it. The only way this fridge will be useful for somebody is if it's been cleaned up, you know, and rewired. But I can't, with a clear conscience, sell it to somebody with all this rust on the lines because I know it's likely to fail. So I'll have to pull this system out, the whole system, keep these lines intact, and put it on a system stand you've seen me use before, the little dollies with the upright posts. And if during that phase these lines break, then I'll obviously have to do some more work to it, but hopefully I don't. And yeah, time will tell. I currently do not have room to take this apart right now and have the parts separated because they take up a lot more space disassembled. So now that I know it's operational, and I found that other spare hot wire relay, I know I'll be able to get it going and fairly easily. So I'll shut it down, let you hear the stop. All right, that's that. I'm gonna call this a video, part one on the little Shelvador. And I don't know when part two will come. It could be a long time from now because I'm so busy, but hopefully you guys enjoyed it. Thanks for watching.